Wishes, I would like to extend my sincere condolences to you all. As today is not an easy day, today is a day where we have come to lay our beloved sister to rest. Our grandmother, our great-grandmother, our sister to rest. Before we start the service, we go and as I call Pastor Judah Matter, he's going to open the service in a word of prayer.
All right, shall we just bow our heads and pray? Father and God, it is in your loving name we give you praise and we give you thanks. Master, we thank you for this opportunity where we could be here. We pray, Lord, that you have blessed us and protect us. And isn't how we have here today, Lord, to lay mom to rest. We ask that you may comfort our grieving hearts, every family, every friend, every well-wisher that is here. We ask a blessing upon them. We ask for blessing and pronounce upon the service and guide and lead and direct. We ask it in no other name, but in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise his holy name. You may be, just remain standing, brethren, as we're going to sing our first song. We're going to sing the first song. If you have a program, we have the old account was settled long ago, and that was one of her favorite songs. She loved that song, and because of that, we're going to just sing it along. See if we can fall in love with that song likewise. There was a time on earth when in the books of heaven an old account was standing for sin yet unforgiven. There was a time on earth when in the books of heaven an old account was standing for sin yet unforgive. My name was at and many things below. I went unto the keeper and settled long ago, long ago, long ago. As the old account was settled long ago, and the record set today, for he washed my sins away. As the old account was large and growing every day, for I was always sinning and never tried to pay. But when I look ahead and saw such pains and woe, I said I want to settle and settle long ago, long ago, long ago. So yes, the old account was settled long ago, and the record set today, for he washed my sins away. And the old account was when at the judgment bar, when I stand before my King, and he the book will open and cannot find. Then what tears of joy will flow, because I had it settled and settled long ago, long ago, oh long ago. As the old account was settled long ago, hallelujah, for the record set today, for he washed my sins. Yes, the old account was settled long ago, when in that happy home, soon coming from above. I'll sing redemption's story and praise him for his love. I'll not neglect a book with pages white as snow, because I came unsettled long ago, long ago, long ago. Yes, the old account was settled long ago. Hallelujah, and the record says today, for he washed my sins away. As the old account was, oh sinner, seek the Lord. Sinners, repent from all your sins. For thus he has commanded, if you may enter in. And then I, 100 years or so, you surely won't regret it. And settle long ago, long ago, long ago. Yes, the old account was settled long ago. Hallelujah. And the record said today, for it washed my sins away. Yes, the old account was settled long ago. Long ago, one more time. Long ago. Your account was better long ago. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. We give God thanks and praise for our sister had it settled with the Lord. Praise the Lord. And we're not here today because we're so sad and we have to send her off. We are happy. And we know for a fact that our sister is sleeping, and she will be awake at the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. For those of us who knew Mom, well, I used to call her Mom, if you know that she is somebody of a high spirit. When you come to visit her, she always have something wonderful to tell you. And now that she have gone to take her rest, we want to send her off in a wonderful way. Let's turn your Bibles with me. We're going to read the scripture for the day. For scripture for the day is from Psalms 116. Psalms 116, we're going to read from 1 to verse 5. Praise God, we're going to read. Because he has heard my voice and my supplication, because he has inclined his ears unto me, therefore will I call upon him as long as I live. The sorrow of death compassed me, and the pains of hell got hold upon me. I found trouble and sorrow. Then call I upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, deliver my soul. Last verse. Gracious is the Lord, and righteous, yea, God is merciful. We serve in a merciful God. And we want to thank God for his son, Jesus Christ, where he has made it possible that right now we sitting here know we have a hope that we will see our beloved sister at the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. By this I call on Sister Ruda, and she's going to come up with a special song. Wanting.
reaching out to hold me when I had a nightmare. You could read quite the story in the magazines online. Years of work and worry had left them marks behind. I remember mom's hand, how they held my daddy tight and patted my back for something done right. There are things that I've forgotten that I've loved about my mom, but I'll always remember the loving mom's hand. Soft and kind when I was crying. Mom's hands were harder still when I'd done wrong. Mom's hands were always gentle, but I've learned to understand. There was always love in Mom's hands. I remember Mom's hands working till they bled, sacrificing selfishly just to keep us all fed. If I could do things over and live my life again, I'll never take for granted the loving Mom's hands. Mom's hands were soft and kind when I was crying. Mom's hands were harder still when I'd done wrong. Mom's hands were always gentle, but I've learned to understand. There was always love in Mom's hands. Mom's hands were soft and kind when I was crying. Mom's hands were harder still when I'd done wrong. Mom's hands weren't always gentle, but I've learned to understand. There was always love in Mom's hands.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And she said, she's a granddaughter, so she knows what she's saying. I may not know about that, but she knows about it. Turn your Bibles with me as we read the second scripture for the day, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we're going to read from verse 12 to verse 20. And I read, "Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen. And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and our faith vain is also vain." Our faith is always so vain, sorry. And we have found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead be raised not. For if the dead raised not, then is not Christ risen. And if Christ be not risen, your faith is vain. Ye are vain yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If in this life only we have hope, in Christ we are of all men most miserable. Last verse. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruit of them that sleep. Praise his name. So Christ is our example of the resurrection. If Christ has been risen, brethren, believe it, that mom will be risen likewise. If Christ is our example where resurrection is concerned, then we will see our beloved grandmother, mother again. And to those of us that have not given Christ our lives, it is important to note that there is a judgment, there is a life after death. And Mom has made her calling and election sure. And we give God thanks and praise for that. Let's all stand. We're going to sing our second song. Our second song, I'll Be Somewhere Listening. I'll Be Somewhere Listening for My Name. When the Savior calls, I will answer. When He calls for me, I will help. When the Savior calls, I will answer. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening. Somewhere listening. Somewhere listening. We have to be listening for our name, because one day when the roll shall call, you have to be present. We're going to have our eulogy. We have Christiana, better known as Nati, Joe Battis, and Joseph Mata. You all are going to come up and do your eulogy.
Marie-Thérèse Jean-Baptiste, better known as Mom of New Village Castries, was a loving mother, sister, aunt, grandmother, great-grandmother, friend, and mother-in-law. She raised her children as a single parent and worked tirelessly to ensure that they will always fail. She worked for many well-known persons, including Moplezi, Sanchez, and the Licks. Her love for cooking led her to create many incredible recipes. Some of her well-known junk foods were tamarind balls, tablets, jam, and turnover. At only 6 months, Mom took me in and raised me until I was able to take care of myself. There is no time in my mind I could picture Mom not being there for me. Mom was always full of stories, although I heard it many times, I never got tired. Mom loves sitting in the balcony watching people go to and from their homes. Especially when Ignatius came home with fish or coconuts, she would come up with a conversation until Ignatius gave her a portion of fish or some coconut water and jelly. She would always argue with him about completing his place. Every Sunday, and would always ask me how many years would my father take to finish his space. Mom always loved company. She loved when family and friends came to see her or call, and she would be sad when she felt they didn't spend enough time with her. I am elated that I was one of the fortunate ones to be raised by their grandmother. I don't know where I would be without her.
Before I read, I'd like to thank every one of you here today that have made the effort to be here to come lay mom to rest. According to Auntie Heather, her first daughter, I cherished mom. We all know that Mom was a professional cook and all of her dishes were delicious. She decided to teach me to cook her Sunday family meal. I had to take a big spoon of gravy for her to taste. She would send me back to add a little more salt, then again to add a little more garlic, or it seemed like there was always something else missing. I went back and forth and back and forth, again and again, until it was to her liking. Back then, I got upset at times, but now I look back and thank her for her teaching me so many great recipes that I have shared with my family and friends. One of my favorite memories of Mom happened just 2 months ago. I called Mom, as usual, to see how she was doing and realized that she was feeling a little down. I tried to encourage her, so I changed the conversation and asked her how her neighbor in New Village were doing. And Mrs. James' name came up. She told me that Mr. James does not live there anymore. Then she said some lady came asking for Mr. James while she was in pain with her one leg. She said to the lady, "I have one leg. Why is it me that you are asking for Mr. James?" We both erupted with a loud laugh that lasted for 2 minutes. I then asked her to repeat what she told the lady. Mom said it word for word a second time. "I have one leg. Why is it me that you are asking for Mr. James?" This time we laughed even louder and longer. I will hold this moment close to my heart because it was the last time we laughed together. Sophia, her daughter, said, "Though Mom had a tough life, I admire her strength as she battled through. She got back on her feet and worked hard for everything she owned. She would tend to her garden and clear the land herself. She loved coconut water and mangoes and would bring home all kinds of fruit from town or work. Mom was a very good cook, according to Tessa. She got
She got her to like breadfruit. Her breadfruit and stew chicken was the best. She said anything she wanted to eat, Mom would cook it for her. She enjoyed listening to her stories of the old days. She remembered the comfort of sleeping by Mom after having a nightmare or two. Tessa and Mom had a tight bond, but once she got in trouble and remembered Mom poking at two of them under the bed with a broom. Mom was quiet yet friendly. Mom was a quiet yet friendly person with a good sense of humor. She loved our trips to the beach or trips to visit relatives and friends. She loved the fresh breeze when I brought her home to visit. Mom enjoyed listening to her favorite country and Western songs. We would sometimes play for her. Now her days have ended, but so has her pain and suffering. Rest easy, Mom. Another favorite of Mom was her making what you call junk foods: tamarind balls, tamarind jam, gooseberry jam, golden apple jam. I remembered us pulling weeds in my flower garden and Mom helping me paint a closet. I remembered Mom getting mad at Pinky and me for playing Scrabble all day. She hit us with a shoe. Although it didn't hurt, it changed the momentum of the game. These memories are forever etched in my mind and now bring smiles to my face. When I got in trouble, she would say, When I get you, it's gonna be for all. Well, one day she got me with a shoe and she made more noise saying Egan's than nothing hurt. It was not a laughing matter back then, but now I can laugh at these memories. If virtues such as these deserve a tear, come pour your grief because mine is buried here. My dad, Randolph, remembered his mom as hardworking who did her best to care for her children. He will never forget his favorite stew box, meals, and Kool-Aid juice. He admired her courage and the bold step she made when she decided to give her life to Christ. He made it his duty to pick her up on Sabbath mornings so she could attend church services. He will cherish all those lessons we learned from her, and her memory will live on in our hearts forever. Her memory will live on in our hearts forever. Mom was a fighter and one of the strongest women we have known. She survived a heart bypass for 10 years, an amputated leg from diabetes. Despite the many odds, Mom never got dressed nor lost hope. Mom never got depressed nor lost hope. Her strong mind and perseverance kept her alive until our Heavenly Father called her home. She lived a full life with laughter and sorrow, surrounded by family. Today, as we gathered here on her behalf, although we will miss her physically, her physical presence in our lives, let us not just grieve, but let us celebrate her life. As she lived a full life, as we talk and visit, let us share our memories as her memories continue to live in our heart. As Mom would say, "My darling, you are right. May her soul rest in perfect peace."
Thank you. God bless you. That's why I say, I was wondering where Brother Randolph get to love that box, stew box. But it looked like his mom that was operating. Mom that passed it on. And I just want to say to those of us who are here, loved ones, family and friends, that it is so important for us to spend quality times with each other, because we do not know when we will miss that individual. And we need to pay close attention to the times that we live in there, because it's not promised to us any, that we have any long time. Mom lived 89 years. How many of us today is going to live to see 89 years? give God thanks and praise for his grace towards us. We have a special song that's going to come up. Sister Jansel Thomas is going to come up and do her portion. Sing a song in Jesus' name.
One, two. One, two. We'd just like to take this opportunity to sing part of the eulogy in song. It says, she loved more than anything else. Someone once asked, if only you knew how short life would be, what would you do? What would they say when God called you home? What would they embrace once you were gone? I hope they would see what you've done in your life, who you cared for, and how you survived. I hope they'd say,
she loved
more than anything else. All of her heart,
she loves
everyone she believes in.
She loves,
oh, 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 she loves. She loved the Lord, she served all. All she had, and through every trial, she made life much sweeter because of her smile. Everyone would see what she's done in her life, who she cared for, and how she survived. I heard them than anything else,
she loves
with all of her heart.
She loves
everyone she believed in.
She loves,
oh, 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 she loves.
Jansel and Sister Grayson, she loves. Mom was a very loving person. Amen. As we get ready for Brother Stephen, he's going to come up and do the sermonette for us today.
Good afternoon, family and friends. I want to thank God for you being here this afternoon to join us in celebrating the life of Mom and finally putting her to rest. Amen. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Our Father, we thank you for this gathering here today. And in Jesus' name, we commit ourselves to you, our family, those in sorrow, our friends, those grieving. And we pray in Jesus' name, loving Father, that you would console and that you would comfort and you would bless. More so, may you open our hearts to receive and to understand the glory of what you have done for us. I pray that your word would abound in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, the funerals are generally very, very sorrowful. The songs bring tears to our eyes. The readings, especially the eulogy, it tells of the person's life. But you know, while I was listening to Mom's eulogy, I said to myself that I would love for somebody, maybe my wife, to write a eulogy for me before I die and read it for me. Reason being, because sometimes when we read eulogies, the person it's about don't hear. And today, so many beautiful things is said about Mom, and it is true. But she cannot hear. She cannot hear these beautiful things about herself. So maybe one day I will have to ask my wife or my family members to write a eulogy for me. The one they may read when I die. And read it into my hearing so I could hear what their thoughts are about me. Because only then it would make sense for me. But I guess it is all for, not for her, but for you here listening today, to get a feel of the kind of person she was in her life, in her experience. And I'm sure some of you can relate to what was read in the eulogy. And I realized that day after day, funerals take place and you know, people are laid to rest and the families grieve and there is sorrow. And I ask myself if we take to heart what really is happening. Now today I'm not here speaking to Mom. Mom cannot hear me. I'm speaking to you. And the beautiful things about funerals is that that's maybe one of the best times that people listen. That's one of the times they are most attentive. And that's why I want to speak to you this afternoon. I want to speak to you about a little bit about what is happening here today. The reason for this funeral. And I want to speak to you about something that you can do that Mom may have done. And today we are gathered here to finally see Mom physically for the last time. And then to bring her to the cemetery and to lay her to rest. And we always say, may her soul rest in peace. And Mom's soul can only rest in peace if she left this world in peace. It's the only way she could rest in peace. And friends, today, what we have here, I will explain in the book of Genesis, when God created human beings and he placed them on this planet Earth, it was for man to exist forever. When God in the beginning created the Earth, there was not to be something called a funeral. So funerals were only invented after. But in the initial intention of God, it was never for funerals. So people like Rambali and Crix would not have a job if we got it right. But sadly, we didn't get it right. Our foreparents didn't get it right. And what happened is that the intended purpose for which God created man, which was to serve him and to live for him and to obey him and to do his will, because man deviated from that, it caused a shift in the creation. And because our foreparents decided to go contrary to God's way, or to God's will, or to God's plan, or to God's purpose, or to God's word, there was a shift in the creation. So because of that action of disobedience, death entered the creation. Man was never made to die. Man was made to live forever. But because of a bad choice that Adam and Eve made, death was introduced into this creation. And we saw in the Bible, in the book of Genesis chapter 3, after Adam and Eve had sinned, and God met with them, God gave them what would be their fate. In the book of Genesis chapter 3, we're going to read from verse 1. The Bible says, "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, what have God said? He shall not eat of every tree of the garden. And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the tree in the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, He shall not eat of it. Neither shall he touch it, lest he die." God had given an instruction to our foreparents that they should not touch of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, because if they did so, they would have died. And the serpent said unto the woman, "He shall not surely die. For God doeth know that in the day he shall eat thereof, then he shall be, your eyes shall be open, and he shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree desired to make one wise, she took and she ate." So the devil tell her, "You will not die." God said, "You will die." Satan said, "You will not die." And the Bible says she went and she ate. And the very same thing happens today, friends. There are certain things God has stated about this life, and we continue to believe otherwise. And because of we believing otherwise, we do otherwise. And because we do otherwise, death comes upon us. And the Bible says in verse 19 of the same chapter, when God finally met Adam and Eve, God gave Adam what his judgment was. In verse 17, "And unto Adam he said, Because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree which I command thee, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow thou shalt eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it was thou taken, from dust thou art, and unto dust thou shalt return." The process of what is happening here is because mom, in all her beauty, have to complete the process of returning to the dust. She has to return to the dust, because just like our foreparents, the very same thing that they did when they went contrary to what God had spoken, she too in her lifetime did the very same thing. And because of that, it was pronounced that from dust you came and to dust you shall return. So because of that, mom has that bill to pay. But let me explain further, because you know, when God created man in the book of Genesis, the Bible says God took from the earth and he formed man, and then he breathed into man, and then man began to live. So man originally was from the ground, but there is a portion of God which he breathed into man that man should live. Only at that point did man live, when God breathed into him. And today, friends, what lie before us, what happened to mom, is that the portion that God gave to her, he called it back. And the portion of her that belongs to the ground is going to go back to the ground. And that is not just for her, but that is for every one of us. We are pieces of the creation of the dust of the earth seated on a chair. But the difference between you and her is that the life that God breathed into you is still in your nostrils. And what happened to her today is that what God gave to her, it is no more. The book of Ecclesiastes says it goes back to the Creator who gave it. So death actually is a separation of dirt and breath. So that is why the Bible says, from dust you came, to dust you shall return. What is left here is the dust part of mom that is going to go back to the dust. But the breath of mom, which gave her life, has gone back to the Creator. But the beautiful thing, friends, and this for me is not very sorrowful. Because I'll tell you why. It is sorrowful, yes, that we will miss her presence in this earth. We will miss her. She was a grandmother. She was a great-grandmother. She did many. I could imagine when I saw Mr. Mopresi walking today, I said I will have to say to him openly, thank you for the many plums and the mongo graham mom used to take from his by when she worked at his house. And to bring for us, and you know, I can remember on Sundays, we were running down New Village, the steps, to go by mom, because mom would have graham and plums from by Mr. Mopresi. So I want to say thank you for that, sir. They were very nice. And you know, we will miss that from her. We'll miss her kindness, her care. But there's something that I want to leave with you today that mom did, that I want to encourage you to do. In mom's lifetime, before God took her breath, mom invested in life. She invested in life because she knew the time was coming that she would have to leave this world. And when I said she invested in life, I'm speaking about before mom left this earth, mom found the man who was the originator of life, and she traded this old life for a new one. And friends of mine, if there is one thing in all our eulogy you need to know, is that she died with a hope of eternal life. She didn't die. I can remember in her last days, you know, I say, mom, you know, upa havin check me. She'll tell me, when you're up here, you got me, upa havin check me. Who can you even check me? You know, and at times she told me, Stephen, maybe I pose a come way. Mom did not die sad and sorrowful. Mom saw afar off because she made an investment to find the man who can give eternal life, and she got it. And today, that is why we hear and we are not sorrowful as people that don't have hope. Today, we just here to celebrate her life and to let you know that we're going to see her on the other side. Those of us who have invested in life like she did, we will see her on the other side. So the Apostle Paul says in the book of Thessalonians, do not sorrow as them that don't have hope. For if we believe that Christ died and rose again, those that sleep in Christ will God bring with him. And she invested in life, and she's going to come with him when he comes. But guess what happened, friends? If you want to see her and meet her again, that loving mom that we spoke about, you must follow her footsteps. Invest in life. In the book of John, chapter 5 and verse 11, the Bible states, this is the record that God have given unto us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. The Bible says, he that have the Son have life. And he that have not the Son cannot see life. We're not talking about these little 70 years that God give us. We're talking about a life of eternity. And for those of you who don't know, after this life, there's another life that goes on without end. This is just a very small preamble. As a matter of fact, this one is messed up so much. It is so messed up. This life is so messed up that God has made possible that there's another one coming, but the other one does not have an end. And today we are called to follow the footsteps of mom because she made an investment. And today that's why she could rest in peace. You know, I'm sure if by some mighty power of God, he is to call mom right now and say, mom, resurrect. I'm sure mom would say to him, Father, I don't want to come back in this world. You know why? Because she saw the hope of the new world to come. And friends of mine, if only you could see the glory of what is coming, you will count this life as nothing. But you know, we human beings, you know, we have this issue with us that for us to believe things, we must see it. We believe we have to see it first before we could make a decision on it. But today, the Bible is calling us to make a decision by faith, by squarely what God has said in his word. The Bible says, God said, Christ said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you should be also. In the book of Revelation chapter 21, the Bible says, God said, I will wipe away all tears from your eyes. So I'm told in the life to come, there is no funerals. Poor Mr. Rambali and Mr. Crick will not have a job. Because there will be no funerals in the life to come. Those of us who have invested in life. Today, Mom made an investment, and that's why we sang the very first song. The old account was settled. Mom had an account of sin, and she settled it. She settled it by accepting Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. She settled it by Christ suffering and dying for her sins, that her sins might be washed away, that she could be at peace with God. She settled her account. Today the question is, have you settled your account? Friends, God is not interested in your money. God is not interested in your house or in your car. God is interested in your soul. He has a plan for human beings, a better plan than the one we have now. And he wants to take everyone with him into that new place. A place where there is no pain, no suffering, no diabetes, no pressure, no heart bypass surgery, and none of the following. A place where there is peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. And every one of us who desire to be there can be there. We need only to invest in life. And that investment is to give up this old life of sin and accept the Lord of glory, Jesus Christ the righteous. He came to earth, he was buried, he rose again the third day, and right now he's seated on the right hand of God, interceding for those who accepted him by faith. There's a promise of his coming very soon, and those of us who are ready will be with him in his kingdom. Mom made her investment. Today I want to encourage you to make yours. God bless you in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Brother Stephen, for these wonderful words of life and encouragement. I pray that many of you who are here that have not made your calling and election sure will do so before time be too late. I want to call on Pastor Judah. He's going to have a speech.
Okay, we give God praise and thanks. You know, after a word like this, you know, it would almost want you to, you know, close your eyes and die, you know, die in peace because of the hope of what is to come. Shall we bless the name of the Lord? But today I want to, in very, you know, 2 minutes, express my sincere condolences to the family of Mom, and to myself, and to all our well wishers. And I want to say that God gave me a gift. This gift he gave me was my grandmother. Today, it is with deep, you know, sorrow of heart that we are laying her to rest. We cannot explain today the value that this woman had to our lives. Words cannot express. And to every one of us, she meant something to us. Mom had a big heart, and Mom could have loved. Mom loved beyond your flaws. Mom was a giver. She loved to give. And indeed, raising out of a family of 12 of us. And I being the first, I remember my days that mom helped us when things were hard and weary. And daddy, you know, sometimes fall and hard times, mom was there. And mom had a genuine love. Even in her correction, mom loved us. And today, I take the joy and the peace in knowing that she have gone to meet her maker. And she's smiling on the other side. You know, friends of mine, situations like this reminds me that I'm human. And one day I will lie in a box like this. And others will stand before and scrutinize the life that I have lived. And they would speak of whether I was kind-hearted or where I was, you know, loving. But in spite of all this, what really matters, as much as we love mom, in a few moments from now, we're going to rest her in her final rest in peace. And every one of us who loved her, at some time, will turn our back and go back home. No matter how much that love that we have for mom, no matter how much we will stay by that side for a few moments, we cannot and will not be able to go down with her. You know what matters? If she died with the Lord, she will go down with the Lord. At the end of it all, if you die with Christ, you're going to rest with Christ. And this is the hope that we all have. In my lifetime, I have never seen. And as a minister of the gospel, have performed many funerals, for the young and old, some very touching, some as mom who have lived a long life, sometimes you have that hope and you are comforted that she lived her life. But I have never seen in my lifetime trailer trucks of the possessions of what we have acquired in this life drive behind the hearse and go to the cemetery, and the things that we have fought for, the things that we had to put others down for, the things that we had to speak ill of others to achieve, the things that we had to do, sometimes negative things of selling our own soul to achieve these material things. When we go just ourselves. Nothing with us. So what it tells me? Life is bigger than anything that I could achieve in this life. What it tells me, the morals and the integrity that a man leaves is far better than whatever we could achieve in this life. As I close, let me tell you a story. I remember a very wealthy man told his wife, listen, I want, when I die, I want to be buried with every black cent that I own. He said, I worked hard, and I'm not leaving it behind. The day come that he passed, and as the undertakers was about to put him down into this grave, his wife, with tears in her eyes, she remembered the petition of her husband. And she told him, wait a moment, as she watched his face for the last time, she digged into her purse and she took her checkbook. She wrote him a check for every black cent he had in the bank. And she placed it in his pocket. And she said, cash it yourself. This man had a check for all his millions, but he couldn't have taken a walk to the bank. He couldn't have cashed it. Friends of mine, I'm saying to us today, let's love each other. Let us care for each other. There's no value you could put on a soul. And what seems to be riches for me, somebody that could love like mom. She didn't have gold, she didn't have the great amenities of this life, but she was a rich woman because she knew how to love. And today, as we stand and say bye-bye to mom, her memories will always live. If she was a wicked woman, would have dropped this casket in there and walk away, and memories would have perished. But because of her love, her memories will always live on in our hearts. And today, this is what matters to me. Today, I want to employ every one of you that it's time we get to this place of first loving God and loving our neighbors as ourselves. The scripture said, this is the greatest commandment. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, your might, and love your neighbors as yourself. And for me, this is the greatest price that any man could achieve on this life. As I read with you just one scripture, it says, Job 19:25, it says, for I know my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand in the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh I shall see God. Shall we bless the name of the Lord? I know that one day, mom will see God. I want to recognize my cousins that couldn't be here today. Ben and Charlene and Colvin, Kevin, and the list goes on. And, you know, that I know that are watching, Uncle Ken, Uncle Joseph, I know that your presence are with us today as we lay our mother to rest. You know, I wouldn't have said, but mom wouldn't have said it too, but mom had a special love for me. I want to say it. Mom had a special love for me. It's true. Mom had a very special love for me. And not me alone, she had a special love for Pinky too. Pinky and I, mom used to mention in her mouth a lot. And today, it's sad that we have to say goodbye to her. I will miss her. Mom always had a little toilet paper with some peanuts in it. And always hiding to give it to me. You know? Sometimes I used to feel a little ashamed because I say, mom, I'm a big man. I don't eat sweets anymore. And mom would hide it and give it to me. And put it in your pocket. And I have to go in a corner where no one is watching and fold that. But I really used to enjoy it in Jesus' name. I don't know I will ever get a grandmother like this. And I feel blessed that today her children could lay her to rest. Her grandchildren could preach at her going away ceremony. And we could lay this body to rest. We loved her, and her memories will live on forever and ever. To all my aunts, Auntie Lucy, Auntie Sinfi, Auntie Heather, every one of you, you know, we love you and thank you for everything. You two had a very important role in our upbringing. And we want to say from the bottom of our hearts that we love you. Mom brought all this together. Mom didn't have a husband. She didn't have a husband. But at the end of the day, she had. Well, I never met her husband. I never met him. You know? Yeah. I never met him. If he's there, can you please stand? I would like to meet you. But I have never met him. But I know she fell in love with Jesus. And because of this, she had everything. God bless you in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Pastor. Amen. And the truth is out, beloved brethren. I wonder what would Mom say? Judah speaking out the truth. Okay, we're going to have the Mata sisters. Are they going to come up for the signing of the registers? And they're going to come up and sing. And I will call on the witnesses as they come up to sign the register. Sophia, Heather, Lucy, and Pinky. You all are going to make your way up for the signing. As the Mata sisters going to come up and do a special song.
I know your life on earth was trouble, and only you can know the pain. You weren't afraid to face your troubles. You were no stranger to the
love for love.
Praise the Lord. Wonderful song by our sisters. Shall we all stand, brethren? I know you've been sitting for a while. Let's all stand. We're going to sing our last song. Shall we meet beyond the river? Shall we meet beyond the river? And yes, indeed, we will meet. If we make our calling and election right with God, we will meet there one day. Praise be to God. I want to thank all those of you who came out to support the family. I pray that let us not just support them just for today, but we know as the week goes on, we need to call and to find out how they're doing. We need to continue to strengthen them and to encourage them in this time of grief. I'm going to call on Chris. Okay, just one announcement. After the graveside, we go into the cemetery first to lay our sister to rest. After, there is refreshment at the Vitbutei Community Center. I think that is by the Kamen School. By the Lackleri Field. Okay. Okay, elders, we're going to close in a word of prayer by our pastor. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Let us pray. Father and God, we thank you for this proceedings. We pray that your blessing will be upon us even as we take this drive to the cemetery. We pray, Lord, that you continue to comfort our hearts as we lay our dear sister to rest. We pray, Master Divine, for your anointing and your spirit to be with us. Let us, those that are alive and remain, consider, Lord, that investment in you. That when our time will call, again, Lord, we will have invested in a new life. Bless us, we pray. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen.
I didn't know today would be our last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb, I can't feel anymore. Praying you just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. You always make